dry, and very simple, and very spectacular, and little to feed upon, little substance. Beautiful. Our road is one of complexity in the world.
So
does
it
a different approach?
Which one is that one?
That one there, I call it the Bosch.
The long one?
No, that one down there.
Oh, down there, okay.
The strange animal rearing up against the deep space.
Joe, I got a supporter here.
Oh, yeah.
I hear.
I'm smitten, really. It's been 2 weeks now, and the more I look, the more I'm seeing things.
But what city are you from, Mr. Agronsky?
I'm from the moon. I mean, you see the big shapes. You see a color impact. But when you actually literally start looking at areas, it is amazing a number of units there are. And I think it's terrific. You don't see it, by the way, because it takes time to actually stop and look. It's a long looking process. You can't do it like, you don't get it right away. You see an impact, but you don't see, well, why? You can't see all the relationships of either. There's too many to look at, too many to comprehend. Like, for instance, that one down here, the stoic.
That's the gimmick.
Yes, it's tricky, I'll tell you. It's really tricky. So I have to come up for air every 3 or 4 hours.
You may be the start of a new movement, the bathysphere.
Bathysphere
only
school.
One movement that I'm interested in.
The movement of cash toward the pocket.
Cash.
Don't flourish.
No, I appreciate your comments, and keep it up.
Right now you said that. The profile, which took a long time to realize. And then this focal point there. And then you say this one is more of an all-over kind of web, would you say?
Web?
A web of shapes that go like that one over there. You know, from shape to interior shape to near layers, right? So there's more layers and more of an over of a kind of the scale of these shapes is more uniform. You say that spread out a different way than horizontally. And this massive shape here setting off those long inclines like ramps, I think, becomes quite a different composition. I don't want to teach you. I don't want to talk about your teaching your own art.
I'm just
expressing what I can see. I think they came into being and they work in a picture. Then they become valid because
that's what the struggle is. I don't have any at all, any kind of symbolic, you know, meaning, except that this shape will work. And then all of a sudden I see the guys, the figure's holding something.
Mm-hmm.
I had nothing in mind whatsoever. And again, it was one shape suggesting another. And it seemed to give the picture more meaning.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, you know, my background being what it is, I look at these things and they read like symbols. So that's why I asked the question.
Well, a very good friend of mine who's a psychiatrist, you know, he came here and looked at the show, and he laughed when I said I had nothing in mind. There's a lot in mind that you're not aware of. It's just a struggle to make the picture work. I can't use it any other way. And it may very well be that I'm tapping into some parts of the head that I am totally unaware of.
That's good.
I'm not too sure I even want to know. If I have that sense of the picture becoming cohesive, more interesting to me, becoming of a piece, and then strangely suggesting things that I don't even probe too much, but the sense of the picture working, you know that term working, I remember my brother in law asking me, what do you mean working? What kind of work does it do?
Well, how about speaking of work? I like to know that big picture that was a homemade frame. How the hell did you, how did you coordinate all those shapes? There must be hundreds of them.
Are they coordinated? Are they coordinated to you?
It's a tough picture, but it works. Now, the thing is that I just can't believe it's the number of bits and pieces that are in there. It's like an amazing, in fact, one of the students I was talking about was so excited about your painting, a student of mine. He said, he mentioned marquetry. He feels like a marquetry, like wood marquetry, you know, where you have
kind
of
mm-hmm.
fitting in together of shapes. They're sort of glued down into kind of opposing directions and so forth. Or you get it with color besides.
From what you've said, Irv, it's just sort of intuitive.
Yeah. Big canvas picture that I never started such a one of my big canvases. It was cheap, so I bought it. It was a cotton thing. It was all warped and everything. But the size of it intrigued me. And the day before, I was at the art museum making sketches of God knows what, you know, just screwing around. And I had this big canvas and I had these sketches and I began smearing, putting it down. And it went from great clarity to absolute chaos and kept going back and forth. And for some reason or other, I had no desire to give up on it. I was having, there was a sense of, it's crazy even to do a picture like this, and I don't even care if it turns out. And yet there was this fun of playing with all the shapes. And then one corner would seem quite, hey, kind of works, and other areas didn't work at all, and just futzing around until even now I'm not sure whether it works, but there is some sense of cohesion enough to say, hey, let it rest for a while. And I go about and say, wait, I don't want to go with those guys, I don't feel comfortable with them, that seems to be the problem. But somehow the country survives and does okay. We'll survive with this administration in the same way with the pictures. As long as to feel enthusiastic about pictures and your own work without letting sort of the tendency in another direction get you down.
Mr. Nahan, would you like to talk about your like to talk about your influences or that's too complicated a subject?
Why don't you tell him to tell you your influences?
I could see something you could do, Joe.
I'm doing it. Yeah. That's what you're supposed to be doing.
And they're all over the place. Yeah. What would you say, Joe? You see?
Matisse, I see Paul Klee, I see Picasso.
Why not? Yes. See Lenny Agrons? Agronsky, do I have to say ski?
I know.
Yeah. You see everything under the, why not? Yes, you're absolutely right.
So.
Yes.
Yeah.
All the guys that you
know.
All the guys that you love.
You know, Hugo. Oh, I love Hugo.
You know, in this
why
one.
Not?
Yeah. That's part of the fun, isn't it? You know?
Yeah, that's true. You do it.
Right.
I didn't see in this one, down here, that still life, that sort of formal still life with the sort of misty going off above. I see your Roger de la Farnée.
Well, the cubism.
The cubism, and also the very fine harmony in that picture, extremely close harmony of color.
Yeah, look, Len, you've been looking at these pictures and working with them so intensely. You've been giving me and these pictures your full attention.
Yes, you're.
And you're coming. Wait a minute. Let me. You've been coming up with very positive, constructive, things for me.
But you go to prep.
One of the reasons.
Pardon me.
Did you go to prep?
Is that why I feel good? That you're giving me your attention, right?
Yes.
And those that won't give the attention. So why should I give a shit about those that do not?
I know, but it's been, I really was going a little crazy. Until this student of mine made, really was so enthusiastic, and I realized that this guy refuses to, or because of his lack of awareness of what's actually happening in the world, he was genuinely enthusiastic about these pictures. He said, what about this and that and that? And he was pointing out things to me compositionally that you were doing. I said, this guy is keyed in. He's keyed in. See, he's not biased. He's just looking at, he's looking and saying what he sees.
Well, it's easy when your education, in a way, can
be in the
make
way.
You make you
biased.
It
can also
work both ways.
Right.
I'm sure we're biased. Maybe I don't know if Joe would agree with me. By many of the values we picked up from the Lawrence.
But
values.
That's not a bias. Because it's based on objectivity, supposedly. Okay?
Yeah.
That's not a bias.
But it wouldn't be stretching it too much, and I don't think I'm putting, maybe I don't understand what the word bias means. I almost
well,
feel
I
in
mean
favor.
Prejudice. I mean,
it doesn't mean prejudice.
Well, you can have a bias in favor of objectivity, though, can't you?
Then it's not a bias. I mean,
I think it is.
Okay, then let's say that we feel most strongly about the things that that have reached us, maybe in our youth as we are developing, and even now, what
yeah,
we
I think that
feel
matters.
That has a clarity and makes sense.
I think the generational thing is another ingredient in all this. In other words, like when Picasso was shown a Pollock, a picture, and he did, he tipped over the bottle of India ink on his table, and the ink says, went in all puddles and everything. He said, Jackson Pollock. That means he's showing his generation and a whole orientation to the whole history of art, actually with Picasso, but still, his orientation, as wide as it is, would be difficult for him to accept this new kind of thing that Jackson Pollock was doing back in the 40s and 50s. So, even Picasso, who was so wide, so tremendously wide in his interest.
Renoir, did he see Matisse? I think he was repulsed by Matisse's.
And what about Modigliani when he saw Renoir?
That's right.
Disgusted him, the rear ends or something.
Yeah.
Disgusted him. And yet he was a very sensual painter himself in terms of sexuality.
Well, how can we almost avoid that? We don't want to be blind to new developments, but we also don't want to be blind by what is simply very popular too.
Also, there's the novel. There's a question of novelties now going around. This so many thousands and thousands and thousands of painters, young painters, millions of them, popping up all over the place, searching for a novelty.
Gimmicks.
And gimmicks.
Did you see Anselm Kiefer's show at the Museum of Art?
Yes. Oh, no. So we saw it at the Art Museum.
Irvin said,
believe this shit.
The shit.
Honestly.
I couldn't believe the reverence that the pictures were shown.
What about this Jasper Johns for the $4.5 million, you know?
Well, here's...
And I thought that it's a bad painting, just in terms of the painting up there. It's cut in three parts, and they don't go together, and it's a stupid thing, and it's $4.5 million.
No, what about the $17 million one?
All
right, but this is what I'm saying about the worldly success path. In other words, there's a certain direction.
It's all PR. It's PR.
PR, unbelievable.
It's all PR.
Even people.
And if you're really
the gallery that takes you in New York is taking you not to be close enough to
what they can do, right? Because they know that.
Ah, you're here.
His initials in the collar.
Oh my goodness! How about that?
Oh my!
And since you knew Dr. Barnes.
Well, you can say that you have.
Is
you
it
have,
silk?
You have
it's made in France. It has the tag on it, and there are his initials.
My. Irvin, you can say you've donned his mantle.
Oh, it's so good.
It's so good.
I can just see my daughter coming
up. Look at
up
the tail.
And
look at the tail made out of.
That's unbelievable. And this is about the last thing I ever expected to get in my home.
I found it.
Will it fit?
That's a dark.
Jack, do you know Dr. Barnes?
No, Mrs. Barnes has had all this in it.
This is in a way where we're all related to.
Unusual.
I
really love you to come there. You and your
wife. Sewed on.
The foundation. It's on the outskirts of Philadelphia.
Well, yeah, some of these days.
The bag.
You've got the hook in the bag and everything.
Here, what can I give you?
What you did. You know, this one is the shapes, the diagonal shapes and so forth. This to me, an assistant way picks up the big Durable Foundation, the TC Durable. Those shapes go like this, you know, and the news play over. I see that in that. There's basically flat shapes, there's the figure, organic shapes.
Simplification of shape and
impressed with the actual artistry of it.
Maybe it's a unique.
And it, he was able to see the.
He's able to see it. He was able to step aside from his own interests, and I think it's a mark of his an artist who's freer, you know, to that you know can say something like that.
And it still is that clear, but if someone comes up to it fresh, that identity is.
Well, to me, it looked like a helmeted figure with a plume, or a bird sitting on top of somebody's head. You know, it has that quality. But aside from that, the light coming from behind. Silhouetting the figures forward. The birds in the front, it's wonderful. Like it's like a fresco.
It does have a clarity that is, I don't know why.
Clear cut
well,
space like the character.
That's right. The quarantine clear cut shapes in the background.
Stages in your work.
It was absolutely a dividing line, yes. Because instead of working on older pictures again and again, I really did start
like a close-up of an Italian
rebuild the studio, was able to paint the rebuild studio at night, so I was able to spend more time and there. And there was an urge for a change. There was the loss of many pictures. But almost, I'm not clear about this, I almost like a strong urge to do something else, you know? And I think the pictures have changed since then.
Yeah.
There was a less emphasis in most of the work, many of the work, or much of the production was in the drawings and then the weekends of painting, but with the night available to me, I began painting much more at night. And it urged, I think, to make a not a better statement, but a stronger statement. So even I guess night painting almost, of course, it's very dangerous in the way working at night as far as color goes, because there is a change, but they're almost insisted on a stronger pattern. Rather than very, very subtle colors.
I understand. I see in a lot of your paintings dark grounds. You know, does that come apart from the fact that you're painting at night?
It seems like this going to the dark, you mean like the dark backgrounds and things, almost in starting too with a very dark canvas instead of a white canvas. You saw what you were putting down, you see what you're putting down much more quickly. You lose almost an immediate luminosity when you lose your white ground, but you get a stronger pattern.
Sure.
A clear, stronger pattern.
Comes right out.
Right. And I think that helped. It suggested almost a stronger, more dramatic composition. Maybe I felt more dramatic after the big thing that happened to me. But strangely, as the new ideas and the new way started coming, I really have not lived in regret about the lost pictures. Unless I really concentrate to make myself feel sorry for myself. No, the excitement of moving in another direction, also a certain amount of insecurity too, because you didn't know how people would respond to it. But I was feeling comfortable. I know the first dark paintings I was doing bothered Polly very much.
They bothered her.
Well, they seemed depressing. She's worried about me being depressed, I think. But I didn't feel
so it was a wife's worry more than something. It wasn't concern about art.
Well, it could have been both, because she really does not like heavy, dark pictures. Mm-hmm. She loves the Flemish. But it was both, you know. Mm-hmm. But I didn't feel depressed about it. I felt excited by the, and not at all sure where it was going to go. But at this point, I feel very comfortable pushing strong contrast, pushing maybe more dramatic compositions. It's lovely working with very subtle colors. It's very seductive. It's you know, but I felt the urge to do something you know, a bit more different, instead of being so subtle, maybe even heavy-handed too, and not really care so much.
None of these pictures create the fire. Is that right?
No, none do. Not one of them do.
I've shifted the camera down now to this group.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if there's anything in particular you'd like to say about them.
Well, are you hitting the
big one and the four or the three landscapes at the bottom?
I'll tell you, well, just looking at the group, to me that the big picture really should be seen with the small pictures on the bottom. I think I've never saw the big picture look as work as well with those there. Of course, that's
work. That's interesting. Yeah.
And I'm seeing that constantly here. Just quickly, the big composition really was started quite a few years ago, maybe a year or two after the fire, when a couple Ed and Kathy Folks came and sat for a whole group of us. We had a lot of fun that day. We had a whole group down the studio. And I started this big panel. And all we did was chat and bullshit. And we had a great time with the friends. And they were just so, they seemed to enjoy sitting with us.
Mm-hmm.
And the start that I got was a very, rather very realistic double portrait, and I worked on it for years and years, and I'm saying years, mm-hmm. you know, and I was happy with the start, but I could not clinch it, and the folks always would ask me about it, and then I put it aside, the folks, yeah, right, I put it aside, and when I switched to acrylics. And here was this oil painting, and many oil paintings around. And one of the big no-nos about oil and acrylics, you don't put acrylics on top of oil. You know, you can't put a water-based medium.
Right, because it doesn't cover even clots or
oil. Right, it just would not take. But I had these pictures around, I'm starting the acrylic, and I discovered this spray that would isolate the painting underneath, and the spray also said you could paint with any medium on top of that.
Uh-huh.
I said, I'll take a chance. I put the acrylics on top of that. I don't know, the people who own this picture should know, they'll probably worry about it. But working with acrylics on top of the oil brought it to this stage after 2 years.
You seem to have sort of absorbed the central figures in these architectural forms, arches, what looks like tile, and just a lot of shapes that appear to be architectural. In addition, there are these sort of smoky, arabesque kind of shapes.
Yes, yes. It's a strange bringing together. From a very realistic setting, I think it became something that is you know, much more highly patterned, much more decorative, And yet there is a sense of the figures sitting strangely within that setup. And for me, I became comfortable with it. I felt that it resolved. I don't know what the couple, if they'd see it now, would feel that.
Have they ever seen it finished?
They saw it in one other stage and liked it.
Yeah.
And it was a much more, it was still in the total oil stage. And in a way, it was sold in the show, and I felt I was delighted to sell it, but I was also, I felt that it really belongs to that couple. Although I don't know if they'd even want it. But I think the landscapes underneath pick up some of the things of the bigger picture. But it won't be going.
Those three landscapes really seem particularly of a piece.
They do, and that's interesting, Jack. And that's what the show, I think, is doing for me. I mean, you just go, like when you write your poetry, I mean, you don't think of maybe this relating to an earlier, you just do it, and then perhaps if you'd ever collect your work, you'd see this consistency.
Right, I understand what you're saying. These three paintings are not that closely related in time, then.
No,
you didn't think they were about the same time.
They're not at all. And I guess, again, this is what Lenny did for me in this arrangement. And he showed me about sort of consistencies or connections that I didn't know about. That makes me feel good because I feel again. When you go back to the studio, like I went back this past week, you don't go back with any vast changes in them. He said, no, just keep working. Keep working and the consistency is there. Well, like, you know, find itself.
This is very.
I don't know if that makes any sense.
It sure does.
But that's what I feel better about than anything. What I felt was sporadic and jumping and going from here to here. Maybe that's it, you know, and just leave it happen. Sometimes it'll be good to eat, and other times you're going to throw it out, but generally I haven't felt the urge to throw anything out. The center of the picture, the
whole cat?
Well, actually, did you see our cat? Main coon cat.
No.
I was, you know, this is very unobjective. I was sitting on our deck, you know, having early morning coffee before the dawn, and this Eddie the cat, these Maine coon cats, they look like coons, by the way. And it's a lazy cat. You know, I was looking out the view, and all of a sudden, the cat jumps on the railing. It's a big, it hung over there. Big fat thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I got a picture. And I made the most
awkward. It came to you.
I made the most awkward sketches of it. And finally I put it down on canvas. And it took a long time working this out. But my daughter Jenny, you know.
Sure.
And it's hers by her claim years ago. Any cat or dog picture is hers.
Oh.
You know, my boys would never ask for it. Like, oh yeah, that's mine. They mustn't be sold or anything like that. So, this is hers. But the Strati New to the left, I'm sure anybody knows Rodin's sculpture of Balzac.
Right.
Did you ever see that?
Yes.
Yeah, I did a sketch of that, and actually the guy, I've been doing a lot of overweight, middle-aged nude men recently, you know, almost without embarrassment, they remind me of what I think of myself.
Uh-huh.
But I hope there's a little bit of humor in it, too. The one above is clearly related. related to Paul Klee, one of my great loves. It's a picture that simply did not organize for the longest time. And I just smeared those glazes over it, and it became a lot less cut out. And I had the guts to put it up and call it my own, but it's very related to Paul.
You see our whole wall full of landscapes out there? Or is the whole wall
The barn landscape is something a little bit different.
Well, you know Hopewell Village? Have you ever been out to Hopewell? It was actually taken from some sketches that I did out of there. The pictures, almost all of the pictures had a kind of twilight or effect or even a pre-dawn effect.
That's really one of the most distinctive parts of your voice, I think.
Well, at this point, again, I don't know why, but those are the times of day that I particularly love the best. Mm-hmm. But I also think it's just also a way where the pictures in that particular light seems to organize for me. Often when they seem to be pulling apart and are uncomfortable with the pull, I glaze them, and there it is, that time of day again.
Right.
So it is a time that I love, but it is also a way of helping me organize.
Well, there's a lot of, to my mind, there's a lot of mystery in your paintings. There's a lot of things that emerge on closer looks that really aren't immediately apparent. And I'm talking even about just objects in the field. And the way these things are lighted, it seems to me, is kind of consistent with that. Because there is a mystery about a lot of it. What's that word for making things pop out by illuminating them? Chiaroscuro, is that it?
I believe so.
Some of the things I see here make me think of that very much too.
Well, I'm dreadful in real life as compared to the life of the painting with facts. I think I would make a dreadful reporter, just as my son is a wonderful reporter. And if facts have never fascinated me, but I think effects, like light effects, have. And maybe this light, too, obscures the fact that I know very little about facts, or it doesn't compel
really
me.
Interesting.
I never even thought of it before you asked, but I love, walking, after knocking yourself out painting all day, and you're all, in the Yiddish word is pachadet, that means you're all smoked up in the head, and just like walking, through the fields or in the woods in sort of like a twilighty thing, and just not absorbing the names of the trees or anything, which I don't know, but just feeling comfortable in that light. Mm-hmm. I don't have to think too much, but I can still suck in the atmosphere a little bit.
Yeah.
And you as a poet, I'm sure we would find words for it, but I can't. Oh, poetry is far removed from reporting, isn't it? You've done both.
It is, sure.
And you're tapping into something entirely, both are very valuable, but into something very different.
The stakes are a lot higher in poetry, that's for sure. It's much riskier to try to mine out some image and then have the faith to say this may have some meaning and some emotional import for someone else besides me.
It is risky.
Nothing like that happens in reporting.
You
have a formula to follow, and it works real well for you.
Right. I'm sure on your point, you say, what the hell are you saying? Even though it's very dear to you what you formed, and you may not be crystally clear of what that meaning is, but you feel strangely attached to those arrangements.
Absolutely.
You know?
Absolutely.
Why should anyone feel attached to this arrangement of color and shapes and whatever? Why? I don't know, but I do, you know? Just like you do with your, you would with your own kids.
It begins again and again, too. That's an interesting thing. It seemed to me that there would be some sort of temptation for a painter to make the same painting again and again and again, which I don't see happening here, but just sort of almost to be guided down familiar paths all the time.
Maybe that's one of the blessings of not being successful.
Lucky you, huh?
Yeah, in a way, yes. There is nobody waiting for you to do that thing that was successful.
That they've seen already and want to own.
And your close friend, like with, say, with Lenny and a few others, they don't give a damn about being successful. Mm-hmm. I mean, they are able, they can just share. It is rare. So you also share in a lot of different levels. Like Lenny deals with it very intensely. I love the sharing with my kids. Each one in a different way. And my son Dave, the reporter, he will say very few words about a picture, but almost invariably, when he picks one. Even though he's wonderful with words writing down, not in the saying, he usually picks something that works better than most of the other pictures.
He's incisive.
Right. My daughter will only pick something where the subject is also attractive to her. And my oldest son, Jesse, who really deals and sort of endures complexity, seems to go for the most complex and the strangest ones. But lucky for me right now, they seem to be sharing this work in all those different levels. And it's sort of pleasurable in all those.
For sure.
As you'll find out with your kids.
I hope so. Kind of remains to be seen.
Well, just real quick, I got to think of, like, my sons. The first time I found out that they had really individual eyes, I worked at a Jewish center as an art teacher. Mm-hmm. They gave you almost nothing, but we could use their swimming facility. I took my boys swimming Wednesday nights, I remember. And afterwards, we'd go to this great diner. They had nice desserts. And they had paintings all around the place that for sale, whatever. And, you know, these were the kind of paintings that you would expect in a diner. But the kids were very young. Uh-huh. And I asked them, I said, what do you think of them? They didn't like them. And, you know, they said, there's nothing to them. That's what they said. I said, my God, they can see. Because there's nothing to them.
It's a great story.
Yeah, nothing to them.
Now,
what should we do now?
I'm on this sort of subaquatic looking one in the center here.
Boy, that one, the original was that underneath that is a picture, you know, of Hereford Mountain. And it really looked like Hereford Mountain and the valley. But you started futzing around after a while.
Pentimento.
Pentimento,
right?
Right. Mm-hmm. It was one of the first of the acrylics on top of the oil, the big no-no, that worked for me. That made what was underneath better, that didn't organize. At least it organized. And it really encouraged me to try it on the other picture, which they may self-destruct, but we'll see. But just what that, you know, the acrylics allowed me to be more, allows you to be, the word is more precise, maybe even more linear in a way. where the edges can be very, very sharp. I always avoided sharp edges in the oil paintings. That's why I couldn't even get them too much. But I didn't feel comfortable with them. But Polly is very interested in the Flemish, and I became much more interested in the Flemish too. Their line is very incisive.
Mm-hmm.
Very. I remember meeting an older painter who described the Flemish line as the high note on a violin, I never forgot that. And when he said it, I didn't care for the Flemish at that time, but I really liked them.
What's happened now is that technically you're able to do much more of that hard edging with the acrylics, and you were able to manage.
And change very quickly. Mm-hmm. I mean, I can go through a dozen changes with the acrylic in one day, whereas with the oils, you would do a section and let it dry, but by the time you came back to it, maybe the incentive, each day there are like different incentives or different urges.
Mm-hmm.
And when you came back a week later, it's a different urge. So they would go on and on and on, the paintings. Here you can go through that whole thing in a day. It can work both ways. I think you can be so incredibly tricky with acrylics, you know, there, and technique-y too. I don't think you can do that with oils as well. And every once in a while, I see that happening. I take a razor blade quickly and scrape it out, you know. Not that I'm not afraid of that, but maybe I am.
It's just where the technique,
right? Where the technique becomes the thing more than whatever those unexplained other urges.
Mm-hmm.
Picture.
This next one is one of my favorites in the show. I like that very much.
This the figure sort of figure thing.
This one here. That one, yes. Was one I saw in your
studio. Yeah. It was the last picture I worked on.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, and I wasn't as sure of it at all, but I knew it was somewhat different than the other ones, and the hell I brought it along. There is a great pleasure. Playing with your material, you know, playing, and almost it's a sensual pleasure in a way too.
Mm-hmm.
And I think without it, the fun, I can use that word fun, and it's fun, of painting would be that much less, would be so much more of a drier intellectual experience.
Mm-hmm.
That,
I understand, yeah.
And there, I think the playing around with the material, particularly.
The joy in making, in other words,
making it,
rather than just contemplating it. Mm-hmm.
That's why I think, I don't think the art schools or teachers emphasize that as much as developing a technique, you know, working hard and developing skills. Yes, there is skills, but the thing that may break down your inhibitions might also be in saying, have fun with your material.
Mm-hmm.
Have fun with words. Do you have fun with words?
Sure.
Play around.
All the time.
Futz around.
Mm-hmm.
And the playing around, I think, can open doors, because you don't know what's going to happen. You don't predict it, and it isn't.
That's exactly the way it is when you write. You know, that sometimes just seeing a pun or something that maybe is silly and will have no place in what is completed, that nevertheless suggests ways of thinking that lead to the finish.
And aren't you surprised when you come in a way?
That's one of the delightful things, sort of this joy of happy accident.
Right. I would wish that they would teach that more.
Encourage that.
But maybe that takes away from the authority of the instructor and the teacher, where, you know, and saying, hey, it's not really me that's going to make these discoveries. You don't really need me. You just need that sense, or rather more that sense of the discoveries. You will just make the discoveries. Yes, Lenny.
Listen, are we making progress? You didn't seem to be moving from here.
Well, we're having a good time just bullshitting.
I know.
Well, what do you want done, Director? I need to do all the fucking pictures, okay?
We are, but very gradually.
We're going to be here for 4 days. What? All right, do you have a suggestion?
No.
Just say less.
Well, maybe.
Are you got the machine on?
Oh, yeah. Oh, I see.
Taping it. You know, that case, you want to
please,
get that word
this is my tape. Watch your language. You know how sensitive I am.
But at least you're not talking too slow. That's good.
No, I'm talking very fast. Yes.
Do you play that tape that the baritone of the show?
Oh, yeah, sure. I see it.
It's very slow. Word.
You know, I notice you're talking faster here.
I talk much faster because I'm on word.
It's not his tape.
Not mine, but you're talking more.
Okay, then I guess, sir, we should move.
Move on to the next.
You want to get us out of here?
Cluster.
I was in the summer of
up there. Is that it?
Right.
You know what? The easiest thing to talk about is not directly what make up the picture. Almost the easiest thing to talk about is maybe, and it has very little to do with the picture, is like the subject and where it started,
mm-hmm,
you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I will tell you that because I don't know where else to begin on these. But the long panel. Really started out again, just like the composition of the couple on the end wall, as a very realistic portrait of my father-in-law in profile. Just to see how far, father-in-law in profile, sitting outside, and the background was really the farm across the way. And again, when my wife saw it, I captured his face unintentionally, very realistically. It happened a long time ago. But after years of working on it and not being able to resolve it in a realistic way, the picture took on a totally different life. This, you know, there is a, go ahead, Jack.
Something that seems religious and ceremonial about it.
Well, when you think of where the beginning was of the picture and where it went, it even surprises me. It's something that I that just seemed to gain its own momentum and ended up in that direction. And I didn't even know that it has that.
Mm-hmm.
Although there is that.
Well, you have the sort of cowled-looking figure, suggestive of a religious figure, a monk or something, a thing in the middle.
Right.
Some sort of a monstrance or something. I don't know.
Right. I don't. Well, the very realistic portrait ends up, you know, there.
Mm-hmm.
The picture clinched ultimately after Lenny's sculpture show. And that illuminated white figure in the middle really reflects one of the pieces of sculpture that he had in the show.
Mm-hmm.
That, when I put that up in there, it changed the whole character of the picture.
Mm-hmm.
And it does have a kind of, it does reflect some of the earlier religious paintings. Without me feeling consciously religious, you know, I wasn't after any God like things, just again, something that would help me organize the picture. The one above, that odd, almost devil-like figure, you know, with the big ears.
Are these marble?
The character came from a sketching at the art museum that had a display of Persian miniatures. And I loved the paintings, but the characters in the paintings, they just intrigued the hell out of me. And I had so much fun making little sketches of them.
There's definitely some sort of Oriental suggestion to it.
Mm-hmm. And I never dreamed of making a painting out of it, but there was a canvas and this little sketch. And there the picture came very, very quickly. It's very thinly painted. And I have a, I don't know why, I have a particular fondness for that one. So I keep it in my bedroom. The one next to, the one next to the animals.
Somewhere between Edward Hicks and Rousseau. A lot of influences you can see in there.
Two painters attract me very much. Of course, Rousseau. There's no painter I feel that I could live with longer. You know, his. Innocent like he is, or natural like he is. The world that he creates and the way he uses his means. It's just thrilling to me. But I took a walk one evening with my dog years ago and made a sketch of him sitting out in the
landscape.
And the cat came over and said, "I'm sorry." And from that little sketch, that very odd picture came out. It's a picture that my whole family enjoys living with. I mean, my daughter, because it has a fairy tale on it. We put it over the piano we got from my daughter. Now it's the piano picture. Illustrates a scene. I think there is a scene there, or a, I don't know if you see it, but I very much see it as a setting of something happening there.
Sort of a picture with a story to tell.
Yeah, it has a storytelling quality.
I do see that. It looks like it could be an illustration for a children's book or something.
Right. But the thing I think that that interests me is the kind of space effect it has of very much going close at hand with a certain density in the foreground.
Yes.
And the very deep space goes far. I am very attracted to that in the pictures. And it's very much what happens where we live, in a sense. You look out the window and you have the deep space.
Right.
But that play of close at hand and deep space and a kind of where the what is going on deep in space not only sets a contrast of here and way back there, but I think rhythmically connects with what's going on in the foreground. The Italian Renaissance painter, Cassino Tura, I think his name is. I only saw him I saw him in Europe, except a couple months ago, I saw a little painting of his in the at the Met. And I remember this was way back in 1953.
I like that too. Yeah. This reminds me of the figure.
Struck by the kind of close at hand, very rhythmic quality of the illustration, close at hand, and then the very deep space and the way the rhythms in the back, way, way back there, so beautifully connect with what's happening up in front. It's always, not, I would say haunted me, but say, ooh, I would love to do something like that. Mm-hmm. You know, that is in mind, you know, sort of, in the background there, to make that kind of connection that what happens in the background, what happens is every bit as vital as what's happening up here. You know?
Well, certainly what happens are with that sort of, I'm resorting to the word mysterious again, but with that curious sky and those patches of luminosity in it, they contribute to the sense of magic that this picture conveys.
Like it very gives much. It sort of like what happens perhaps in a fairy tale. Mm-hmm. Again, mm-hmm. That
a more than real world.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yes, yeah. And because I am not like a, you know, vague and vague person. But in the picture world, I feel comfortable doing it.
Yeah, it's an interesting thing.
I don't have like a literary, you know, sense. I don't think I could ever make those stories. I can make up lines, yes, but I mean to like my daughter and my son who would write. I'm sure my other son could do it too, but. I guess.
Yes. Thank you for sharing these with us.
I'm just trying to say something in the picture that I cannot say with words, and that's it's okay because it's fitting to the medium.
Well, it wouldn't be appropriate to take a picture like that and say, here is the literal sense of what's happening here. It's bigger than that. It's got sort of a. I'm having a hard time pinning this down in words now, but it doesn't demand a plot, just as a sense of things, really, more than a linear storytelling from A to B.
I would feel very comfortable with that.
What's in the figure's hands?
What's in the figure's hands?
Well, I think it took. Initially, there was nothing in the figure's hands, mm-hmm. but there was the background, all these things were going on, and what was put in the figure's hands was to pick up like some of the themes that were going into the picture. In other words, this wasn't a conscious thing, but a need to place some shapes or volumes or colors in that area to make the picture work. And somehow it took on the shape of suggesting grass objects without really identifying them. The person that bought that picture calls it the vegetable picker, right? And which is about as far as my mind as I ever dreamed of.
Yeah, I certainly don't view it that way.
No, but it looks fine. Like I mean, Dr. Barnes made up all of his own names, right?
I called him an Aztec king, and she said,
"Oh, that sounds a little bit more."
That's what I thought he was. Remember, she said, "Oh no, he's a vegetable seller." I thought
you
was an Aztec king.
You know, that really but
those
is
objects
you know,
are not vegetables.
you know, it, you know, it,
See, I looked on these as his tools of his imperial majesty,
sure.
Receptor and all of that.
I think
she saw it as a fish and vegetables.
I think we're a bit more
like that. You like that?
I'm going to move down to the three at the bottom here.
What?
The two heads together. He calls it Flea Market Charlie.
Who calls it that?
You.
That must be Lenny. He gave it that name.
you Flea Market Charlie. I call it the Aztec King. You call it Flea Market Charlie.
I call it the Aztec King.
I call it upper level painting.
Can I get you something?
You are a real boy. You don't need to look at names or that.
I'm looking now at the figure with sort of the face.
The squished in face?
Uh-huh. Yeah. Buried in the hand.
That's another one of the pictures, the very last ones, that I was sort of rushing to complete and didn't expect to complete it.
The actual next one is it?
Right, flush on.
The big one?
No,
the one below it.
The one right.
Because the
where was
the lady with the arm?
She says.
Yeah.
I don't.
I mean, I was turned down today. I offered somebody else one. She said, we don't have any room.
That was a nice way. That earlier. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. But I guess interesting.
I think she'd be thrilled.
Well, I would be delighted. It would, because I just want to go back to the studio. I know that's like, I didn't mean that as an imposition.
Not at all.
Because I think, I think it turned out living with something.
Sure, sure. Well, the one thing that's always sort of sad about that is that it kind of tends to vanish. You know, it becomes so familiar that you don't see it.
Oh, yeah. That's so true. That's why. Right. That's true. That's why when you have a visitor, you feel like, you know, really is sort of generous or alive can, you know, wake you up. It's the same way with like mm-hmm. Lower living. You know, you can grow and like complacent with the view and all that. You get someone like from the city and say, how are you? When you look around, you say, oh, maybe
that's it's been, you say to yourself, it's 2 months since I realized how beautiful a place I live is. What about the two pictures here? Below and slightly to the right of the long panel. Anything in particular you'd like
to? To the right of the still life and the. The animal business, you know, that's going on.
We're going to try something.
Okay, you try.
We'll make a grouping out of three heads. Don't put it back.
You mentioned hicks earlier.
Mm-hmm.
That was a competition.
Did you ever be sorry with the show?
I had some
fun.
And
that was really
fun
to play with.
And I was at the art museum, and I came across a hicks. It's something
the
to do with
kingdom.
Each show, although he's an entirely...
Yeah.
Huh?
It's haunting the peaceable kingdom. That was the case.
Right.
That could work with this because there's affinities of color.
Well, I don't mind haunting you, but I don't want to give you nightmares.
I was wondering if that would be better over there at this point over there.
Yeah.
Does anyone ever have? Does that one kind of look into this?
Oh no, that's Harry. Let me see.
It is. You're right.
Did you remember that? Did you do that from life? Or did you do that from life?
How did you know that was Harry?
I knew immediately. First I saw it was somebody else.
And that's the painting that I made of it.
Where? The one with the height?
Yeah. I want to send this to church. I think I'm calling it.
Oh, you did.
I should have shown that Harry was at the show. His wife would have smiled. He would have hit me.
Verbally.
Destroyed me.
I wish I'd had the camera running when you and Lynn were talking about the big panel in the center here before.
Well, shall we get my new...
There's so many drawings you can go nuts.
Well, that might not be a bad idea. It's a wonderful thing to say about it.
Lynn, a request from our dear friend here. He said you were making some brilliant comments about that the large composition that you probably forgot it. Can you remember it?
No, I was just amazed because of how to resolve so many shapes and colors and units. That's hard. That's hard. But I think it works. The other thing is, I think the frame carries on the painting too much. Joseph, I feel he's right. If that had a simple frame, it would help it.
It what?
Would help it if the frame stopped. At the end edge of the picture and not continue the way it
should. Oh, okay, you are criticizing.
Joe said that, I agree.
Okay. For a minute, I thought you were complimenting my friends. You have been.
No, I like it.
He's right.
But Joe, on the other hand, it's a little tough because the picture is so. Okay.
I'm sorry, Polly's going to hear this, but she thinks some great frames.
Can you edit that out?
But what about those brilliant comments you made about the picture? The tape is running. Let's hear some. You can stand up.
Oh, it has been.
Come on. Now you're on the spot. All right. You don't have to, but you don't get paid as much.
Well, it's the same. It's similar. This is easier to analyze.
Go ahead.
Something like that. This is so complex. It's a tough job, and you see so many keep looking at it. For instance, I didn't realize that this is a figure. I have no idea this is a figure.
When was this that you
I just know at this moment I saw
oh,
this.
Oh, God. Now, wait a minute, I don't want to...
This is really like...
You said that was a figure.
Yeah, I know you spent years on that, but
that was the most recognizable thing in it.
Oh, I see, it's evident.
No, I didn't see it immediately.
No, you didn't?
Okay.
Nancy, did you see this figure? Did you
say it?
Immediately.
good.
You're feeling hurt, Lynn?
Do you see Connie Mack in that picture?
Connie Mack? You mean the stadium or the man?
No. I see Satan or something like that.
Is that the door? Somebody?
No, that's the...
The alarm?
No, the firehouse across the street.
Oh, that disgusting like sound.
The door's doing
it. It's like a...
That rattles the art center. Every time you hear them, they really turn up the volume.
It's really a vulgar sound.
It is.
It's about it's like a herd of 20,000 elephants letting go at once.
Connie Mack picture or Connie Mack politician?
I was actually lying. I was hoping he'd see it. Well, Lenny's too young to know Connie Mack anyway.
There's a new Connie Mack.
There is related to
grandson.
Said what he has to say.
No, we mustn't go off on tangents.
No, that's a tough one. That is a tough one, really.
I don't think it really works 100%, but either you or not.
I can see it has a structure, absolutely, but it's a tough one to talk about because it is so rich.
Why doesn't it work? Why doesn't it work?
I think it doesn't take its place as clearly as some of the others, but maybe that's just part of the picture that it doesn't. Although I feel comfortable with
it. I think if you
still doesn't work, does it, Joe? Okay. Well, as soon as I get home, I'm going to... As a matter of fact, a couple of these pictures had more patternings on these frames, and I washed it down that one and a couple of others. But I became so intrigued with doing patterns on the frame. Who ever thought of doing patterns? I was having a better time than in the picture. I said, stop.
Well, that's what you were doing. You were continuing the process of exactly. The picture on the frame, and that You're was right. defeating the purpose of the frame.
Right, and I know years ago that was a no-no that we learned, but I couldn't help it. I kept going. It became getting more elaborate. And
compulsion.
You
know, it's not like...
You're getting larger and larger and larger.
It's not like the mosaic frame that's arrived.
Another friend of mine helped me put these frames together. It's a wonderful furniture design.
Does anyone get it?
And he didn't want to do it as simple, you know, make it as simple as this, but I was in such a rush and I felt ashamed to ask him to work on it. But he came to the show. Well, you've always had exquisite
Good
taste.
For you. Good for
and
you.
And he said he's going to help me with frames again, where the structure of the frame will have more to go going on it, so that I won't even feel the need to
put it. Well, you know the frame, the German frame on the Bosch painting at the Foundation.
Right.
That's a painted frame. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, but it gives you an idea of how you can paint a frame and yet still make it work as a frame.
Right. That is fabulous.
I don't know. I would like to see the painting on the wall by itself.
Forever, but
could
by the way,
all the traditions.
Polly gave me a great deal of money to take everybody out to supper tonight.
Oh, so no, we're leaving. We're leaving very shortly.
You can.
Oh, yes,
we must.
Yes. Her dog is in the park.
My dog's in the park.
Bring him. Well, we've been talking so much that we might not finish it all today. Besides which, I thought you were going to be leaving.
Seems like
evidently, that's not happening now.
Tell me about your pressures.
Well.
And can we make a phone call to relieve you of the pressure?
No. Camille has to go to work, whatever I tell her, you know, I guess about 5. So from there on, the kids will be with a sitter. Now, I don't know whether it's going to be a hired sitter or whether it's going to be a neighbor that she's asked to watch.
No, I don't. And I can't deal with it.
And then if you, to call,
I'll phone and see just.
I have a reserve on that.
Huh?
I have a reserve on pigeon for the beer.
Thanks.
Yes, thank you for being patient.
Drive
bye.
Careful.
Thank you.
taping this.
Yeah, I really hope the podium by white. She'll never hear it.
She didn't hear that. That part I wasn't taping anyway.
That's not really a lawyer.
I'm really fucking irritated with my wife.
I don't know that. Are you taping now?
Yeah. Here's what it is. She's hopeful that she can get a sitter who will be able to stay with the kids all night. Okay? She won't be able to answer that question, though, is the sitter available until 4:30? All right? If the answer is yes, then I don't have to work. I can get home whenever. If the answer is no, she has to take the children to my mother's house, and that means that my mother has to cancel her plans for the evening, which, you know, I don't want to do. Of course, doesn't really matter, actually, the way it is, if that happens, I should try to get home as soon as I can.
Not to
impose too much on dealing with this. So I'm going to continue the taping here, and at 4:30 I have to call again to see whether she's made the arrangements.
And if not, we'll just dash home.
Right.
See if I can get money to. What time is it now? Oh, it's
my sister.
Which one?
taping
giving
individual
time
shots.
For
yeah.
To be seen. I
right.
see.
Strange feeling of going inside there and removing creating something that's been part of your smelly body for some years.
And you felt it as a personal loss, huh? That's not really the way I felt about my teeth.
What, did it feel good to cry?
No, it just felt...
Or maybe that is the trick.
You have to give the picture.
Because that's just a crap that goes through my mind when I'm painting. It's never about the picture. Well, a little bit.
Maybe sometimes.
I'd like to say something for history now, too. Can I, is the tape ready?
It's running, yes.
What could I possibly say?
We're looking at the big landscape in the middle here now.
That was the first, solid picture I finished after my fire. It looked like those light areas are weeping, doesn't it, a little bit?
Yeah, it looks like it's sort of a...
This was the beginning of the underwater.
It looks like a partially rain.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And I was going to repaint this, but I don't know.
A lot of people like this one.
They
do. Large comments that like.
Hmm? You mean from this area? Other professional painters here, and how very removed they felt from these pictures, and you felt the, that.
I felt like I was going nuts because I heard such negativism. I couldn't believe it. Look. Pictures. Stop saying things. Just look at the
picture. It was in mass, huh?
Mm-hmm. No, it wasn't in mass. They came in individually at various days and times. I would say the reaction was about, I showed five, a couple of other people too. There were people that guy was in your opinion.
Yeah, so was somebody.
Those two guys were.
I don't know how I would.
Question of looking. Most of the people just didn't have the patience to look. One person who walked out, a student, I think, who's more knowledgeable, not just in us, around the church, she said that her, just escaped my mind. Oh, I can't be bothered. Right. Different directions. And if you're working with the complexity, richness, and fullness, this other person is working for not complexity, but the simplicity, purposely, simplistic, not richness. Impact, yes, impact. It's like, and I always think of impact, I think of cartoons in New York. Get an impact, you get the joke. It happens in a period, in a matter of seconds, not instantaneously. And then you turn the page to the next cartoon. You go through the whole New Yorker like that, enjoying
it. But there's no discussion of the poem. And if you listen to a really good news analysis, like public radio or public TV, you want to, they really want to chew on something. Patience to listen to that is simply not there. It's what you've been fed on. We've been fed on pictures that take a lot of chewing.
That's right.
And I'm damn glad we have.
Exactly.
We can go to a museum and the old boy, not the patience, not the interest. So,
it's not
obscurity that support each other. That's part of the art world too, that simply is not well known. Who knows how many thousands, how many, look, America, let's talk positive about American, no shit. There may be thousands too, it simply is not out there. It's the art world, only that which is well known. We're part of the art world, maybe we are a very vital part. So, how's that?
I hope you're right.
No, really?
Someday.
What the heck? It isn't, I mean, because there is this, let us be well known enough to receive encouragement and to be able to do, maybe to support us a little bit. But for that massive interest, you know, or that massive renown, you would probably have to team up with a merchandiser, right? Who